And we're also going to talk to Michael Hiltzik. Michael Hiltzik is a longtime columnist for the L.A. Times. Mr. Hiltzik has been stand-up enough to come on the program before. We've had him on to criticize columns that he's written. And he's written another one, which we're very unhappy with, and he's coming on to defend his column. And in this column, the column was about the minimum wage. As you well know, a bunch of fast food workers are demanding that they have their minimum wage increased. Some are demanding to have the minimum wage increased to $15 an hour. And President Obama has also weighed in and said that the minimum wage should be raised.
It's well past the time to raise a minimum wage that in real terms right now is below where it was when Harry Truman was in office.
Now, I try not to be too astonished when I read left-wing columnists like Mr. Hiltzik. And by the way, have you noticed that all of the columnists the L.A. Times has, all the local ones, every single one of them is left-wing? I can't think of a single right-wing local columnist since I've been reading the paper. Can you? Michael Hiltzik, left-wing. David Lazarus, that's their health care guy. He's left-wing. Pat Morrison. One time she told me, Pat Morrison did, that the constitutional basis for Obamacare was in the part of the preamble to the Constitution that says provide for domestic tranquility. I said, what? So she said. So she's a little left-wing. Sandy Banks is left-wing. She once wrote to somebody who wrote to me that Larry Elder earns a living by keeping the foibles of black people in front of the faces of white people for fun and for profit or something to that effect. She's left-wing. Steve Lopez, he's a guy that has clueless about how often Americans use guns to defend themselves. And when he was in a gun store, the gun store owner told him how often Americans use guns to defend themselves, and Lopez told the gun store owner, according to the gun store owner, where'd you hear that? Store owner said Larry Elder. He goes, oh, that's the guy who is no longer on KBC, meaning I got fired for being incompetent. Who knows what he meant? Anyway, clearly do not look at Larry Elder as a source for any kind of credibility, said Steve Lopez, according to this guy. He's left-wing. Skelton, their Washington, Sacramento guy, is left-wing. So if there's a conservative local guy or gal that I've missed, let me know at 1-800-222-5222 at the L.A. Times. I can't think of one. Jonah Goldberg is a conservative, but he's a syndicated columnist. He's not writing about local issues, not writing about the mayor, not writing about the DWP, not writing about the police, not writing about crime, not writing about unfunded pension liabilities. Not writing about the fact that L.A., when you compare it to the other major cities on the West Coast, is considered to be the least business-friendly city of all of them. All their local columnists are lefties, including my guest, Robin Apkarian. Robin Apkarian is coming on because she wrote a piece, and she said that the knockout game is a myth ginned up by conservatives who are stoking racial animus for fun and for ratings. Really? The knockout game is a myth.
Hi, I'm Reverend Al Sharpton. The knockout game is not a game. It is vicious. It is ugly. It must be stopped.
When Reverend Sharpton is more sensible than you are, I think it's time to just check yourself. Here is the mayor of Philadelphia, Nutter.
First and foremost, this is disgusting and inexcusable behavior. And it's not a game. You can seriously injure or possibly even kill someone with this kind of activity. It's also a very serious crime to assault someone. The Philadelphia Police Department and the district attorney will, I can assure you, treat it as such.
Russell Simmons.
Knockout game is no game. There are no winners, only losers. To attack defenseless people is not cool. It's cowardly and unacceptable. You must take the opportunity to condemn violence and bigotry wherever and whenever it appears. Join me, Reverend Al Sharpton, Mark Morial, Rabbi Snyder, and the Foundation for Ethnic Understanding in saying no to hatred and bigotry.
No to chaos. It's all about credibility, isn't it? Robin Apkarian writes a piece where she says that the knockout game is a myth, and she cites as an example of what can happen when you stoke up fears the conviction of those five for the sexual assault on the Central Park jogger. Robin Apkarian actually believes that these Central Park joggers who were convicted are innocent. And she gives that as an example of what can happen when there's racial hysteria. Unbelievable. And I have been fact-checked. So she hasn't been fact-checked on whether or not the Central Park Jogger 5 actually did it. She doesn't think they did. They did. And Mr. Hiltzik has not been fact-checked, where he says that there's no documented evidence whatsoever to support the argument that minimum wage laws actually destroy jobs. Anyway, both Michael Hiltzik and Robin Epkarian are going to be on. And again, we salute them for coming on. In a few minutes, Michael Hiltzik, longtime columnist with the LA Times, will come on and defend his piece, where he said that there is no, that the case for the minimum wage, the case against the minimum wage, quote, that it costs jobs is entirely undocumented, end of quote. We'll be joined by an economist named David Neumark. David Neumark teaches at UC Irvine, and he's looked at over 100 major academic studies in the last 30 years on the minimum wage. He looked at that in 2006, I believe it was, and we'll have him talk about his conclusions. He's also, David Neumark, received an award for a piece that he did on, well, the minimum wage. All of this in just a few minutes. We're also going to be talking with Robin Epkarian. Robin Epkarian is also a columnist with the LA Times. Among other things, she said that the knockout game is a myth that's ginned up by conservatives seeking to stoke racial animus for fun and for ratings. And she also said that this is an example of the kind of thing that can happen when you railroad innocent people. Innocent, and she meant that the five defendants convicted of sexual assault of the Central Park jogger were innocent. Really? That's astonishing. I'm not sure which is more astonishing, that she doesn't believe that the knockout game is really going on, that it's a myth, that she believes that it's being ginned up by a bunch of conservatives interested in stoking racial animus, or she believes that the five defendants convicted of assaulting the Central Park jogger are innocent. I'm not sure which one is more astonishing than the other. But we'll be talking with Ms. Epkarian about all of this.
Thus, the consequences of minimum wage rates have been almost wholly bad, to increase unemployment and to increase poverty. Moreover, the effects have been concentrated on the groups that the do-gooders would most like to help. The people who have been hurt most by minimum wage laws are the blacks. I have often said that the most anti-Negro law on the books of this land is the minimum wage rate. And so I think the real answer to your question is that you must not judge a bottle solely by its label. You have to look at what's inside and see what the law or the measure produces.
That is economics Nobel laureate, the late Milton Friedman.
It is no accident that the teenage unemployment rate, the unemployment rate among teenagers in this country, is over twice as high as the overall unemployment rate. It's no accident that that was not always the case until the 1950s, when the minimum wage law, wage rate was raised very drastically, very quickly. Teenage unemployment was higher than ordinary unemployment because, of course, the teenagers are the ones who are just coming into the labor market. They're searching and finding jobs, and it's understandable that on the average they would have be unemployed more. But it was nothing like the extraordinary level it has now reached. It's close to 20%. Why? Because the minimum wage law is most properly described as a law saying employers must discriminate against people who have low skills.
As you know, there is a movement across the country to increase the minimum wage. Many fast food workers want the minimum wage to be increased to $15 an hour. Here in California, over the next couple of years, it will be increased to $10 an hour. And President Obama recently weighed in, too, and also suggested that the minimum wage should be raised.
It's well past the time to raise a minimum wage that in real terms right now is below where it was when Harry Truman was in office.
My next guests are Michael Hiltzik. Michael Hiltzik is a Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist, longtime columnist for the L.A. Times. He wrote a piece which I thought was just astonishing, in which he said, among other things, quote, the old argument against the minimum wage, that it costs jobs, is entirely undocumented, end of quote. And also we're joined by an economist named David Neumark. David Neumark is the Chancellor's Professor of Economics, Director of Graduate Studies, Center for Economics and Public Policy at UC Irvine. Mr. Hiltzik, Mr. Professor Neumark, thank you very much for coming on.
My pleasure.
Sure.
Michael, why don't you go first? Michael, do you want to alter, amend, retract anything before we go forward? The old argument against the minimum wage that it costs jobs is entirely undocumented?
Well, look, even Professor Neumark in one of his papers points out that this is a subject that's been debated by economists since, I think, 1913. There's simply no consistent evidence that shows that the minimum wage, the levels we're talking about, has reduced employment. That's why we're still debating it. because nobody has been able to come to this conclusion. And, in fact, the weight of the evidence is to the contrary, that it does not reduce employment. So, no, I'm not this is entirely factual. There's simply no agreement on this.
Professor Neumark, what Mr. Hiltzik just now said is false, is it not?
Well, I'm not quite sure where the quote of my article was intended to end. It is true that economists have been debating this since 1913. That was where the quote should have been.
So that part of what Mr. Hiltzik just said is true?
That's true, because that's what we first started having.
That's probably the only part of what he said is true.
As blatantly as he put it, yes. The issue of the disemployment effects of minimum wage is debated. It's still debated. It's not, as his column suggests, at least for me and for most people in this debate, a question of ideas or philosophy. It's a question of what the evidence says. Are there studies that don't find that the minimum wage reduces employment? Yes, there are. It's a minority of studies. My co-author Bill Washer and I, we've written a book and about 30-plus papers on this topic. We, about 6-7 years ago, engaged in a sort of really lengthy comprehensive survey of pretty much everything that had been done since 1992, which is when there's sort of a new explosion of research on this topic. Surveyed all the studies, many from the U.S., but some from other countries as well. And we conclude that roughly 2/3 of the studies show negative effects of minimum wages. And then, using what is admittedly our own subjective assessment of what are the better studies, and that seems okay to me, about 80% or more of those show negative effects of minimum wages. So, you can cherry pick studies that don't find negative effects for sure, but characterizing the evidence as there's no evidence or the weight of the evidence goes the other way is just wrong.
Professor Neumark, what Mr. Hiltzik said to be fair to him is exactly, quote, the old argument against the minimum wage that it costs jobs is entirely undocumented, end of quote. To that, Professor Neumark, you say the notion that this argument is entirely undocumented is false.
The weight of the evidence, in my opinion and in many people's opinion, but I'll only speak for myself, is that the minimum wages create some job loss among the least skilled workers they're trying to help.
Mr. Hiltzik?
Well, look, this is not a question of taking votes among studies.
Why not?
As Professor Neumark just pointed out, we have been talking about this for really a century now. If there really were an effect that could be documented, that could be uncontrovertible, I think we would know it. Instead, to this day, we're talking about it. Professor Neumark's own study has been questioned. The question is whether he's cherry-picked the figures. I don't want to say that, but he knows and he's acknowledged in his own papers that his own findings have been brought into question. It's a debate. I'm not saying he's right, he's wrong, anything like that. But we are still debating this, which means that nobody has really been able to put their finger on this sort of effect.
Michael, to say we've been debating it is one thing. To say that the debate on my side is entirely undocumented, which is what you said, is another thing. That's what astonishing.
The fact that we're debating it, we're still debating it over 100 years.
If we had an effect,
we would have seen it by now.
I don't see the logic of what you're saying.
We're talking about, Professor Neumark himself says, he's made a subjective judgment about whether the studies that support him are the better studies he thinks they are or he says they are. Well, fine. That's fine. But the fact is that he doesn't have evidence that is unchallenged by anybody else. And, in fact, he's got to deal with people like Dubey, Lester, and Reich, who found completely different effects. And the weight of the evidence, as they put it, is that there is simply no effect that you can point to. And, in fact, there are even some studies that say there might be a positive effect.
Professor Neumark, I know you want to respond.
The fact is that,
Professor Neumark, we're going to take a break and you can respond. Michael, don't go away. 1-800-222-5222. Michael Hiltzik, LA Times columnist, Pulitzer Prize winner. Professor David Neumark, economist, UC Irvine. I'm Larry Elder, Talk Radio 790 KABC.
It is absolutely essential that we extend the benefits. Economists agree that unemployment benefits remain one of the best ways to grow the economy.
And my guests are Michael Hiltzik. Michael Hiltzik is a Pulitzer Prize winning columnist for the LA Times. And again, Michael, I want to thank you for coming on. You're a stand-up guy. You've always come on, we've asked, and you've never gone wobbly, and we appreciate it.
Always enjoy it.
Professor David Neumark is also with us. He teaches economics at UC Irvine. Professor, I have said that when George W. Bush was looking at the intelligence for the war in Iraq, if as many experts told him, Mr. President, Saddam Hussein does not have stockpiles of WMD, as there are economists who are telling Mr. Obama that raising minimum wage hurts jobs, then if George W. Bush ignored that evidence, he should be impeached.
I'm not going to touch that issue. Let me do what I said. What you said I could do, which is respond to what Mr. Hiltzik said.
Sure.
So, first of all, there's not much served by Mr. Hiltzik and I arguing about you know specific studies because he's a journalist and I'm a researcher and we have different jobs. So let's sort of put that aside or save that for a different conversation. What I've stated are the facts, right? I acknowledge in everything I write and when I do these kind of interviews, the issue is contested. I've described what the bulk of the studies say. I said two-thirds of them, and that's not with any subjective assessment, tend to show negative minimum wage effects. And then I've said when you make a subjective assessment, the evidence looks stronger. But we say that's a subjective assessment. We give our reasons. Other researchers can read it and argue. It's a 160-page paper, but it takes some time, but they can. The third, the notion, the logic that because we're still debating it, it must not have an effect, it makes absolutely no sense, right? We're still debating what the effect of the stimulus was, right, in the face of the Great Recession. Okay? Now, why are we still debating it? That's a harder thing because we don't have too many business cycles, unfortunately. We don't have very many that are anywhere severe as the Great Recession. But why do we do this? Because economists get better at what they do. We get better data. We try new methods. The studies that Mr. Hiltzik cited by Aaron Dube and others have brought new methods to bear, and now economists are sort of picking them apart and seeing what they think. So the fact that we're still – I mean, it's not a physical science, right? We don't prove some law and then move on. It's a natural, it's a social science. So better methods, outside of experiments, because that's not what we do, are needed. So revisiting it means nothing about what the effect is. I should say, though, just to set the record straight the people on the other side of this debate also overstate terribly, right? People on the right, appeal to some of my studies and say, all right, minimum wage has caused some job loss, therefore a bad idea, or therefore, and I think Mr. Hiltzik has some of these quotes in his article, the minimum wage will throw the economy back into a tailspin. Well, two things wrong with that argument. The minimum wage is not big relative to the economy. Mm-hmm. Now, $15 would be, but if we're, $10, $9, whatever, that's peanuts relative to the business cycle. It may not even be distinguishable. No one says minimum wages raise aggregate unemployment. They say it causes job loss among very low-skilled workers who fortunately are a small share of the workforce.
And on that point, and then I want Michael to respond, Professor, here is what I have heard. The chairman of the Harvard Economics Department is a guy named Gregory Mankey. I know you know who he is. Mm-hmm. He has said that for every 10% increase in the minimum wage, you lose between 1% and 3% of jobs. Now, in an economy that produces roughly
Among the least skilled.
Correct.
That's a very small share.
That's right. Among them, it's 1% to 3%. So you're talking about an economy that produces 2 million jobs. So 20,000 is 1%. So you're talking about on the low end, increasing the minimum wage by 10% might lose 20,000 jobs, may lose 60,000 jobs. Now, in an economy of 2 million per year, that's not a whole lot. But tell that to somebody who's lost his job.
No, right. I mean, the numbers, if you sort of do back of the envelope, the kind of minimum wage increases the president's talking about right now, I'm not going to do this, standing on my leg, but you could talk about it could cost about a couple hundred thousand jobs in total, which is about sort of one, current numbers, about 1 month's worth of job creation. Right?
And
huge relative to the economy, but not ignorably.
Correct. But if there were that many sign-ups for Obamacare, we'd be talking about what a wonderful success it is. Michael, you have the last word.
Let me make a couple of quick points about this. First of all, a lot of this has to do with what level the minimum wage is at any given point. And the fact of the matter is that the level it's at now, as I think you had a quote, I think you quoted President Obama saying, that in real terms it's below where it was 30, 40, 50 years ago. It has not tracked worker productivity since 1968. Now, so it's at a very low level relative to the economy. The other point is that a lot of this discussion is irrelevant because whether it loses jobs or doesn't lose jobs or even creates jobs doesn't have much to do with the fact that the point of raising the minimum wage is to give people who earn it more income and a better income and bring them closer to a living wage. And I don't see, where is the argument against that, especially if, as you put all the evidence together, whether there's a job loss effect or not, clearly it's pretty incremental or we wouldn't be constantly talking about it. We would know. So the real issue is, shouldn't we raise the minimum wage to the point that it was in the Truman administration, or the point that it was in 1968, so that the people who earn it actually do better in the economy and have more money to spend, and that's better for the economy for everybody.
Michael Hiltzik, LA Times columnist, Professor David Neumark, UC Irvine economist. Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you, Larry.
Appreciate
My
it.
My pleasure.
1-800-222-5222, Larry Elder, Talk Radio 790 KABC. Well, that was interesting. Who do I think won? Who do I think lost? Well, you know who I think won. And again, the debaters were classy enough not to think of this as a you won, you lost thing. But if you are making an assertion, as Michael Hiltzik did, that the case against the minimum wage is, quote, entirely undocumented, end of quote, and you have this professor from UC Irvine, Professor David Neumark, my guest, who looked at the last over 100 pages, papers of the last major studies on the minimum wage. He did this in 2006 and found that two-thirds of them had a negative effect on employment. How do you say that the case against the minimum wage is entirely undocumented? You can say, I'm looking at the 30% or so that say the minimum wage actually helps things. I'm ignoring the two-thirds. But to say it's entirely undocumented, it's astounding. And when you look at statements made by President Obama's former advisor, economic advisor, Christina Romer, who now teaches at UC Berkeley, even she said the case for the minimum wage is very complicated and its positive effects are entirely uncertain. I mean, the chairman of the Department of Economics at Harvard says every time you raise the minimum wage by 10%, you lose between 1% and 3% of jobs among those people at that level. Well, do the math. We're bragging about the 200,000 jobs that were created last month. That's about 2 million per year. So you lose 1%, that's 20,000. 3% is 60,000. You want to tell 60,000 people, well, other people got more raises, so therefore you're going to lose your job. Tell them about that.